Gary this year.
Some time ago, John told his brother Eric that at the time for a memorial service, one of the things he really liked to hear is one of his favorite songs, Big Red Candy Mountain.
Says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awakening, he will rise up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him, who is my friend and not a stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord. And if we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. O God, whose mercies cannot be numbered, accept our prayers on behalf of your servant John, and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy, in the fellowship of your saints, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Most merciful God, whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, Deal graciously with John's family in their grief. Surround them with your love, that they may not be overwhelmed by their loss, but have confidence in your goodness and strength to meet the days to come. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now the Old Testament reading.
This is a reading from Lamentations. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. For the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone.
I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore.
Every family gathering we've ever had. And I remember when I was a little kid waiting for my brothers and sisters to come over, and I'd wait by the window and I'd hear the motorcycle coming up the driveway, and I'd run outside, and John was the coolest guy in the world to me. Getting off his bike and taking off his helmet and that big smile. It took me a long time to realize that what it really means to be cool is to have a giant heart, and that's what John had, the biggest heart. I'm trying to get through this song.
I have said Reading from 1 John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when He is revealed, we will be like Him. For we will see Him as He is.
First of all, I'm honored to have been asked to read today, and for my Saline Grossman family, and for John, my neighbor in Manchester, the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the right path for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Parents, I like that. So, for those of you who don't know who I am, my name is Kate. I am John's niece and Lisa's daughter. And Matt and I talked about playing music today, and our family is notorious for our communication skills, so we both thought we were going to end up playing Bird on a Wire, which wouldn't really work. So, Matt did Bird on a Wire, which is beautiful. My Uncle John loved people very much. But he would be ashamed to see everybody so weepy. He liked parties, and he liked to have a good time, and he liked people to enjoy life, which is what he did. So I'm not going to play sad song. But I might still not be able to get through it, so I'm going to do my very best.
Would you stand, please, for the reading of the Holy Gospel? Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life. What you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things, and indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. A couple of weeks ago, I attended the first meeting of a new committee on which I'd been asked to serve. The leader of the committee wanted us all to get acquainted and asked that we go around the table and introduce ourselves and tell who we are. It was interesting to hear how people described themselves. Everyone wanted to make sure he or she sounded sufficiently important. One man told us that he was the senior pastor of his church. A woman who plays the organ described herself as the minister of music at her church. When it was my turn, I said that I was the deacon at Holy Faith Church in Saline and the director of Saline Area Social Services. And then it was the turn of a woman whom I really like and respect, who has a long list of credentials. She told us that she was Marjorie Brown, and that she is a child of God. Her answer, I think, was the most important of all of ours. Every one of us, at that meeting, in this room, is a child of God. And so was John. In our gospel reading from St. Matthew, Jesus invites us to consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet, he said, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not clothed like one of these. Think about it. We are each like one of those lilies. Each of us, each child of God, is different. And each of us shines with glory in God's kingdom. When a death occurs and a memorial service is held, there's a way in which the universal and the particular come together. The person who has died is one particular person, with a name, a face, a life story. Yet at the same time, the one who has died is not simply a single individual, but somehow represents all of us, frail creatures of flesh. The poet, preacher John Donne put it this way: any man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind. And therefore, never send to know for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for thee. Let me speak first about the universal, what John shared with every member of the human race. He was a child of God. He was fashioned by the hands of God and given the breath of life. At the center of his being, there was what Scripture calls the image of God, the divine reflection in our human existence. That heavenly image was smudged by things in his life, as it is smudged in each of us. And as suffering lays a hand on each of us, so too did John know that experience in ways both large and small. Then what happens to each of us someday happened to him last November. He passed through the gate of death. But human nature has been united to the divine in Jesus Christ. Through Christ's humanity, ours is redeemed. And so we gather this afternoon in confidence that death is not the final word for John or for any of us. God has made a covenant with us, and God is ever faithful. Such is the universal story. Now comes the particular. I've learned that John loved riding and collecting motorcycles. He enjoyed camping throughout Michigan and the United States. I like traveling in Michigan too. Not camping though. He likes spending time with friends and is remembered for his sense of humor. He loved the years spent with his beloved dog, Sable. His family has told me that he was, at times, uncomfortable in social situations, would sometimes sit in a corner as an observer, but then you could watch him unwind, and his joyous side came out. His sister Lisa said that she feels that John would celebrate life every day. But this particular arena, my friends, is your province rather than mine. Some of you lived with John in the intimacy of family life. Others of you worked with him. Others were his neighbors, both here in Saline and in Manchester. Still others claimed intimacy as his friends. You know the unique features of his story. You lived that story with him. The loss you have suffered leaves you grieving. A part of you has died as well. But I invite you to find, at the center of your grief, the gratitude that waits there to be discovered again. There are things in the journey you had with John, a child of God, for which many of you may want to thank God. It may be a time that he made you laugh, or when you shared a special moment, or a time that he forgave you, or when he asked your forgiveness. So we've come to the time in the service for some of you who wish to do so, to share memories and thoughts of John. Each of these recollections is a treasure that we would do well to share. Going to invite anyone who would like to say a few words about your life on your journey with John. If you'd like to speak, we'll just pass you the microphone so that everybody can hear.
The megahertz type of test, it wasn't anything he looked into scientific standpoint. So, in the middle of Manchester, John decided that, well, I'm going to see if this thing works. So, it was about 11 o'clock, and he lives near the fairgrounds in Manchester, and he had a 357. It was something like Dirty Harry would have. So, he said, oh, I'm going to turn my scanner on and go outside. So he left the scanner on in the house and went outside, and at his fire pit, it wasn't burning at the time, but let loose and wham, 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 three shots in quick succession. And then he said he was quite startled because he said a revolver, the flames shot out in a fan from the sides, as well as 6 feet out the muzzle. So he was quite startled at the same time he was shooting this, so then he runs into the house. And then he's listening for a short time, and then shots fired, Manchester, from Washtenaw County. So then it's John, if you've ever known John, and he's telling a story, and he's kind of saying, you maybe shouldn't have done something. He gets this look and kind of goes, I did something. Though needless to say, John turned out all his lights and was all pink. And the Washtenaw County cars were coming up and down, scanning the fairgrounds and John's place and every other house along there. And John, by that point, is quite frightened, and he's got the plastic blinds pulled down and peek, and he's looking out, all the lights are off. Then he thinks, then the paranoia set in is, I wonder if they can hear themselves on my scanner. So he runs over and quick turns it out, and he might have even pulled the batteries on the thing. But he's just watching for a long time, sitting on the floor, and he sweat that one out. But that's a typical situation that John's version of testing something like a scanner would be. Another excursion, we used to go to the Mariposa Folk Festival in Toronto, and we were teenagers, early 20s, so if you go to Canada, you can drink legally there, and we'd go to this festival, and we would load up. In Canada, you have to go to these beer outlets and buy your beer. They don't just sell it at stores, so we would go in and buy our doors and stock up on stuff, and they have all these bottles, and we'd look at them, and we weren't looking at the quality or anything. We're going like, well, this one's 4.2%. This one's 5. Verdoris is 6.2%. We better get two of those. So we go to the festival, and we had one of those big coolers with a handle on either side, and we stuffed it full and had enough room for maybe a thing of mustard and some ham and things you don't really need. And put those in the cooler too. So after the day was over, we're walking back, and this thing is pretty light, but they recycled their bottles in Canada, and they don't just crush them up and recycle them. They use them, and all the bottles had wear marks where they would spin against each other, and they were real thick, heavy glass. And so we had a cooler full of empties and, you know, the mustard and things that you don't need in a cooler and all that stuff. So we're walking back to the Neil Weizik Hotel, and John and this guy, Dave Green, decide that, you know, they're going to play a little game with the cooler. So they start swinging it, and they were swinging it like this. I think John's on this side and Dave's on the other. So they're going like this with the cooler, and we're all walking along. And so he goes up, you know, on, you know, up like this, stop, and down, and then he and Dave get it and goes, all right, and around, and they go around with the cooler like this. And they do that a number of times with the cooler. Oh, this is pretty cool. We're doing the spin. So John's doing the up, you know, up, down, around, and Dave's doing his bit. Well, Dave and John got their wires crossed. I think Dave was going not around, and John was going down. Well, when you hold a cooler, you're like this. So the bottom of the cooler is a good 8 feet in the air by that point. So if you've ever been in a group of people and you know things are going to happen, I was walking probably 50 feet ahead. I might have been with Paige or Julia. And we heard, you know, the signals, and I looked back while the cooler was frozen midair like this, and the lid drops open. Down comes a bunch of green and brown glass and crash onto the sidewalk. And we were just happening to be walking by a fancy hotel with the guards out front, or the men with, and it was old building close to the street, so it was just a short curb driveway where people would pull up and they would take their vehicle. Well, they're standing out there, and this happened right in front of the place. So we're all wide-eyed and kind of going, "We gotta get the hell out of here." So we're running up, and we see this pile, huge pile of broken glass and whatnot in there. And so we're all ready to scamper, and Dave and John have the cooler, and John says, "Wait, we can't go." And if you've ever drank beer and heard the phrase a dead soldier is an empty beer, John's like, "There's still some good beers in there unbroken." So we're all panicked that the guards are coming over, and Dave and John are over there trying to assemble the cooler, and John's grabbing, and he puts about half a dozen of these things in the cooler, and then we skated on out of there. But it was like, you can almost hear the helicopters overhead, like a Vietnam thing, you know, John saving these soldiers out of the broken glass. And we're all like, we're gonna go. And then we realized afterwards, and John's kind of calmly saying, you know, "Well, we're back at the hotel, and you each got a beer to drink now." So that's something that, you know, I think Dave, you wouldn't have done that if Dave Green was there, obviously. But also, John had a sweet side to him, and if you've ever talked to somebody and they have a story they like to tell, and they have a glint in their eye, and you enjoy hearing the story over and over. My grandma Hagen was in the home here in town, and we would pick her up for holidays and whatnot, and we'd take her back in the evening. Well, there was, you get to pass by some of the residents, and one of them was an elderly man who was in a wheelchair in the hallway, and he had a pipe. They allowed him to have his pipe, and they allowed him to have tobacco in it just for the smell, and he would just go up down the hallway, and he's kind of like an old sea captain, and we would talk to him, and, you know, he'd nod and smile very friendly. And John, one day, had dropped Grandma off after Christmas and was talking to him, and he goes, "Norman, how would you like a light for that pipe?" Well, John always carried his Zippo lighter. Anybody that knows John knows he liked Zippo lighter and keys and things like that. So he got this out, and anybody familiar with Zippos, familiar with that song, sound. I see the eyes glazing over of older people in here that remember smoking. So John, he takes it out, lights that man's pipe, and he just had a beam of a smile, and John just smiled as much, you know, that small thing that he did made that man so happy. It was his Christmas present, and John's walking down, and, you know, here's somebody, "Norman, how'd you like that pipe?" He loved it, and that was the sweet side of it. It was watching John tell that story and the smile on his face, which to me was the essence of John. Thanks.
I think I'm going to go the casual route too, Eric. Until I get warmed up, anyway. I'm Aaron Seif for Bush. John was my brother for 20 years. I'm not going to call my brother-in-law, because he's my brother. And miss him? You know, it's funny how today is really... sorry, I'm not talking. Thanks, Mark. today, I'm soaking up all of us, because he's really touched all of us. And like Eric said, he's had real compassionate, joyful side. He had his own special relationship with all of us. Unique way. I seen the glint in his eye too when he's buying Christmas presents for the kid, for the all his nieces and nephews, and his nieces and nephew. I'm not sure what it is. I'm losing track here, but John, known him for 20 years, and it really reveled in him, and when Martha and I got married to have some new brothers, so it really touched me up. You know, one time we went out on the river, and John had some trouble swimming. And he was tired swimming, and I ended up pulling him out of the water. And Eric, and it was a combo effort by a few of us, but we pulled him out of the water and on the beach. But John and I we'd sit over on our back porch at the homestead and talk about that. And he goes, whatever happens, good or bad, is your fault. John, he had his very compassionate, a playful side. I mean, and it's unique, as Eric put the exact words, that disarming laugh, and it came in right after that comment too. It was like, it's on your shoulders now. I guess I'm a little bit ADD. I kind of bounce around a little bit. I thought I'd be a little more prepared. And, John, he had a real good connection with us. And a story that Shirley had given to me when Martha and I were seen together. I'm a landscaper and planted a lot of trees in my lifetime. And so she bought me this book called The Man Who Planted Trees. And it's about this gentleman, and he's going through this real desolate country, and it's all bleak. The people are sad. There's no trees. There's no wildlife. It's cloudy, and he encounters all these people in just a little dreary region, and he encounters this man who every day he. After he selected the very best acorns, he would plant 100 acorns a day. And they spent some time together. The traveler went away, came back 20, 30 years later, and saw the difference that this man had made. But besides the oak trees, he planted birch and dogwoods, and through the all the plantings, the little woodlots had formed, and rivers and streams kind of started developing from the roots breaking into some aquifers, and then there's more wildlife, and it just shows you what one man can do by touching others' lives, and what a little it takes in this world to make connections, and how important they are. And that's what I'm really struck by today. In this time, it's a sad time, but it's a connection time. And I had some opportunities to talk to old friends, and I've heard a lot of old stories. We could probably number the stories John's told, and we'd all know them. But I loved hearing every time he said it. So I had one last thing, a little poem I found that was kind of touched me. It's a Chinese poem. The fresh and beautiful moon is traveling in the utmost empty sky. When the mind rivers of living beings are free, that image of the beautiful moon will reflect in each of us. Shine on, brother. Shine on.
Cycle bags.
smoked a lot of cigarettes and used to sit all night all the time. And
that was pretty cool, you know? Like, he came to my high school graduation and all my friends from high school were like, who is that? I was like, that's my uncle. That's awesome. I just wanted to say he didn't have any kids, but we were his kids. And he was a pretty cool pseudo-parent to have, you know? He, like, do all the bad stuff with you. But then he also, like, gave you some good advice. And my little story is I've had three serious relationships in my life, and the guys that I brought home, you know, that introduced my grandparents and my family, and John was always there, and he would rank them on how long her hair was. So the longer hair they had, the better they were, in John's opinion, and the more instruments they could play. But every guy that I brought over, John would, you know, go up to them, and Warren is not, she's had the same experience, and John would walk up to them, and he'd say hello, and he'd shake their hand, he'd look them right in the eye, and he'd say, it's nice to meet you, you better be nice to my niece. And, you know, John's like six foot, 6'1", right? And like my, you know, his boyfriend that I bring over would just be like, okay. he loves us all very much. And he tried to be the very best influence he could be, and I think he did a really good job. So, that's all.
I was just going to briefly say, as Kate's mom, that that Uncle John also was certain that each one of his children was going to be fabulously famous. So every single thing that they did, their very first piece of art that they generated, it was another Rembrandt. And he saved everything from them. And they were just, you know, learning was going to work for the consulates and the whatever. I mean, it was just, he did adore them all and had their futures well mapped out. So it was.
My name is John Grossman. In 1845, my grandfather, Johann Grossman, was born. And here it is. In 1845, he was born. In 1865, he came to this country where he met and married a woman of German heritage, and they had 14 children. They had 7 boys and 7 girls. And what would happen?
People don't know, but John had a name for his leather coat. His mosquito brother, that's what he called it. And Eric reminded me, the motorcycle on the beautiful thing that you drew, we drove, I had a 900 Eliminator, and that thing was fast. And Eric reminded me, we went down the Maumee River riding with them, and we sat the switch bikes. Of course, mine was fast, so John loved it. But I told him this was like riding a damn tractor. And fun.
Always nice to me. I came along with children, and my oldest son was only 5 years younger than John, so of course they have their struggles. And he could not be here today, and so he asked me to speak for him, and when I synthesized all the things he said, a long, long conversation, he said that now that he's an adult, he knows that his stepbrother is the most genuine person.
To that point, I and to what you guys have been saying about John encouraging all of us all of the time. I remember when I think I was 18 years older, and started a band with some friends, and we started playing out shows, we were playing at the Blind Pig, and John was always there, and he showed up with bells on. He was our biggest fan, absolutely our biggest fan, and I gave him a CD of our music, and he listened to it. When no one was around, he listened to it. He knew the words. And he was amazing, and he put so much love into me, into encouraging me, and I can't quantify how much of who I am today. He is responsible for, but it's a lot, and he put a lot of love into everybody's life.
I'm Duncan. I'm ex-brother. He married Martha, of course, but I met her first. And one day, a long time ago, she was 16. She took us, she kind of invited me to go down to see her dad's new property down by the river. I don't know if it was new property or old property, but anyway, she took us down there, and she took me down there. And there I met John and Eric,
of course.
Little guys, you know, just little guys, you know, didn't pay much attention, except they were running like crazy, like all the guys do. So, you know, but that was a good day. We shared a lot, you know, me and my one time with the family, you know, that just with Martha and John and Aaron and Alan. That was fun. And of course, I disappeared for years and years, and then finally, he got married to Martha, or he was going to. He was kind of on his route to get married, and went over to their apartment, and this guy comes over, and Martha's just laughing and laughing and laughing, and it was John. She said, "This is my brother John, Duncan, you know him?" I said, "Yeah, he was just a little guy when I met him," and he was so funny, and I was impressed the way Martha just, you know, she just loved John. I could see it in her eyes. And Eric, you know, he brought up some memories talking about John and with the thing that shooting off the gun in Manchester and that went especially well. When I finally was going to get married, he had a bachelor party down at John's house. And you know, I was living in Pennsylvania, but it was well worth the 400-mile drive back there. Because we went down to John's house.
Just a few of us, I think, were there.
And it was, you went right in the middle of Manchester, across from the factory. He's got a big bonfire going in the front yard. He's run out of firewood. And so what are we going to do now? And so what I'm worried. He runs across the street to the factory, and he brought back a whole stack of pallets. I said, "Aren't they going to say anything about those pallets that are missing?" He said, "Oh, no, I'm cool with that, don't worry." just a couple of things, but John's always, you know, such a, you know, nice, you know, company to be around, you know. Basically, that's it. You made a lot of people feel. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug.
Thank you all for.
Yeah, my name's Walt. I'm here with my brother Thad. And we started coming out from Detroit to visit the Grossmans because I think my dad and Alan went to school together at U of M, if I remember correctly. And I'd just like to say I'm really sorry for your loss. John was always, just like all the Grossmans, always really friendly and gracious. And he, you know, invited me into his home in Manchester. And whenever we come out from Detroit, you know, these guys were always really friendly and open. And it was like we're cousins, basically, you know. And I might not see him for 10 years, and they'd be, hey, how you doing? What's going on? You know, where you riding now? You know, what's going on with your brothers and sisters? So I just like to say, you know, thank you. God bless you.
Thank you. I think this is just exactly what a memorial service is all about. An opportunity for us to get together, to share stories, and I hope that everybody is going to continue to do that after we're finished with the service, as you have some refreshment and gather around the tables and continue to talk. Later this afternoon, if there are some who still have stories that they want to share, I believe that most of the SIBs are going to be out at the Grossman Homestead, and people are welcome to drop in there as well. But there are refreshments that the family would like to have you share and share some more of this storytelling. And now, as we conclude our service today, we'll say together the Lord's Prayer, and it is printed in your really neat looking folder that has on it 61 motorcycle and Sable wearing sunglasses.
That's not just any motorcycle, that's a BMW.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom
come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory,
forever and ever.
Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, for sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind. And we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust. Yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, for sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant John. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen.
Amen.
And now let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.